Bismillahirrahmanirrahim. I am Dr. Sana Jibin, working as an assistant professor in Department of Botany, Division of Science and Technology, University of Education, Lahore. This is the 24th lecture of the course, Mycology and Plant Pathology. And this lecture is about the lichens. And in this lecture, we will discuss about the modes of reproduction and significance of lichens. So this is the continuation of our previous lecture. Sexual reproductive features of lichenized ascomycetes are largely equivalent to those found in non-lichenized group. Both homothelic and heterothelic mating systems are known in this group. Apothecia, which are the cup-shaped structures with inoperculate SI, that is the SI in which an operculum is absent and the dehiscence of the SI is and the dispersal of spore is by a split or slit or ostium. So these are inoperculate ascomycetes. Parathecia and Shuddhathecia also occur in these groups of fungi. In contrast, no Cleistothecia or Apothecia with operculate SI known among the lichenized fungi. That is, there are only inoperculate SI are present in these group of fungi. Conidial states, if produced, are often pycnidial. In most cases, the photobiont is excluded from the fertile regions of the mycobiont so that ascospores or conidia, they are released without photobiont cells. A new lichen thallus can be established from the fungal spores only by the process of re-lichenization. And in this process, only when the ascospores germinate, they only form the fungal mycelium, and if they found any photobiont nearby, then they will form association with them. So this procedure is known as re-lichenization. Here in this picture, you can see Soridia in Avernia species. Most lichen thalli produce vegetative propagules containing both the symbionts, that is the fungal partner as well as the algal partner. These can be very variable, and different terminologies are used to describe them. The most common vegetative propagules are the Soridia. Here in this picture, you can see these are the Soridia, and they contain the algal component as well as fungal component. These Soridia are small clumps of hyphae, and they enclose a few algal cells. They are produced over the entire surface of the thallus. As you can see here, they are produced on the entire surface of the thallus. They may be differentiated into the structures known as the Soridia. So sometimes they are directly present on the surface of the thallus, and sometimes they produce specific structures. And these structures are known as Soridia, and in these Soridia, Soridia are produced. Here in this picture, you can see a diagrammatic representation of Soridia. Here you can see this is the Soridia, which is the mass of clusters of hyphae as well as some cellular forms of blue-green algae or green algae, And here you can see the small propagules here. The green represents the algae and the white color represents the fungal partner in the form of hyphae. So these are the Suridia, and when they detach from the lichen thallus, they are capable of giving rise to a new lichen thallus. So these are the vegetative propagules. Here in this picture, you can see Isidia. Here you can see these are the larger upright cylindrical structures which contain both the symbionts, that is the fungal partner as well as the algal partner. They serve to increase the surface area of the lichen thallus, but they can also become detached and then function as the vegetative propagules, as we have learned about the Soridia. So these are the Isidia, that are the finger-like projections or the upright cylindrical branches, and they contain both the partners. Let's see in other picture the detailed structure of the Isidia. Here in this picture you can see the branched Isidia. Here you can see the branches of the Isidia that contains both the partners, and the outer surface which you can see is the mycobiont, and inside the mycobiont there is algal partner. And this picture shows you the detailed structure of this thallus. Here you can see this is the upper cortex and this is the algal layer, and here in the Isidium you can see the green color represents the photobiont, and the outer covering is composed of mycobiont. So this is the Isidium. When these Isidia detach from the thallus, they are capable of giving rise to a new lichen thallus. In some lichens such as Cladonia, the vegetative parts, sometimes the squamules broken off a vegetative thallus and are capable of establishing a new thallus. Sometimes animals can also play a role in dispersing the lichens. That is, the animals may eat them, or they may spoil the structure, or they may break the thallus of the lichen, and this broken part is capable of giving rise to form a new thallus. The thalli of Xanthoria pritina is eaten by mites, and these mites can spread both the mycobiont and the photobiont via their fecal pellets. So they are also the modes of dispersal of these fungi. Since this lichen does not produce Suridia or Isidia, dispersal by invertebrates could be a significant feature of these fungi. Let's start about the classification of one of the members of the lichens, and then we will study its life cycle. Here you can see the classification scheme of Fischia apolia, kingdom fungi, and its division is Ascomycota, class Lecanoromycetes, and the order is Calyceales. But most of the lichen forming fungi belongs to order Lecanorales, but this particular fungi belongs to order Calyceales. Family Fischiaceae, genus Fischia, and species Fischia apolia. And here in this picture you can see the thallus of Fischia species, and these are the cup shaped structures which are known as apothecia. These are the sexual reproducing structures, or they are the ascospore producing structures in which SI are formed, and the ascospores are released from these SI, and these are the vegetative parts of the thallus of this fungi. Now moving towards the life cycle of this species, and in this picture you can see the sexual reproduction in fishes species, and the asexual reproduction in this species is by Isidia and Soridia, and it may germinate by the vegetative propagation by the process of fragmentation. So in this picture we will discuss only the sexual reproductive cycle. Here this structure is formed on the vegetative thallus, and this structure is known as spermatogonia or spermogonia. And the fungal hyphae release some spores which are known as spermatia. These are haploid uninucleate spermatia, and they are male reproductive structures. They release from the spermogonia and then move towards another fungal structure which is known as trichogyne. This trichogyne is specialized receptive structure, and it is originated from the hyphae of the medulla, and it is the specialized type of hyphae which is coiled in shape, and it form a filament which is the receptive filament, and this filament is known as trichogyne. The spermatia release from the spermogonia and they attach to this trichogyne, and they transfer the nucleus to the trichogyne, and this nucleus moves down, and here the process of sexual reproduction is the spermatization. And here the one cell which is formed here becomes the dikaryotic. One nucleus is from the trichogyne cell and the other nucleus is from the spermatia. So here the ascogonium or the carpogonium consists of dikaryotic cell, and this dikaryotic cell then divides by mitosis and produce a number of dikaryotic cells. The inner part of these dikaryotic cells then give rise to the SI mother cell, which produce later stages the ascus, and inside the SI the ascospores are formed by the process of meiosis and then mitosis. So as a result, here you can see the apothecia are formed. These are the apothecia, and if you see the detailed structure of these apothecia, it looks like this. The inner surface of these apothecia bears SI in which ascospores are produced, and here you can see some sterile hyphae are present which are the paraspices. The procedure of this production of apothecia is same as that of the piziza. So you have already read about the life cycle of piziza. So this is the same procedure as that of piziza for the formation of apothecia. So from these apothecia, ascospores are released, but here the operculum is absent. The spores are released from the SI by a slit, and these spores are then moved to moves by the air currents or any other means, and then they are settled on the suitable substratum, and then they germinate to form the hyphae. Since the lichens are growing on extreme environmental conditions, so these fungi do not get the nutrition, so they try to form a lichen thallus immediately after the germination, and they need to get an algal partner. So if they found any algal partner, then they will form an association with them, and they produce some kinds of hyphae inside the algal cell, and then they get nutrition from them. As a result, a whole lichen thallus is again formed. So this is all about the life cycle of lichens, especially the fischia. Whenever we talk about lichens, It is very important to mention here that lichens are the indicators of pollution. Lichens are particularly sensitive to aerial pollutants and especially to the sulfur dioxide. The photobiont appears to be generally more sensitive than the mycobiont. The disappearance of the lichens from the centers of urban and industrial areas was first recognized by Nylander in 1866, who had already correlated this phenomenon with the aerial pollution. So, in the areas where there is more sulfur dioxide, there will be less species of lichens because different lichens show a differential sensitivity to sulfur dioxide. The presence or absence of key species can be used as an index of the level of air pollution. So some species are very sensitive to sulfur dioxide and few species are tolerant to the sulfur dioxide. The most sulfur dioxide tolerant lichen is Lecanora, and it may have evolved in sulfur dioxide polluted areas and went on to the Northern Europe's more abundant lichens by the 1950s. So, where there is more sulfur dioxide, especially in the Northern Europe, European areas, there will be more Lecanora species. This indicates that this species is more tolerant to the air pollutants, particularly sulfur dioxide. So, this lichen may actually require evolved sulfur dioxide levels for their good growth. This is all about the lichens as pollution indicator. Now moving towards the other features of lichens which are very beneficial to the ecosystem and mankind. Besides their role as pollution indicator, lichens are the pioneers of the succession that establishes our terrestrial ecosystem. They are the primary invaders of a terrestrial ecosystem. They secrete lichen acids and helps in weathering of the rocks, which provide suitable environment for the growth of plants. Blue-green algae in lichen association helps in nitrogen fixation. We have already studied the detailed account on the nitrogen fixation by the blue-green algae in our course, Diversity of Plants. Some species of Usnea produce inflammable compounds. That is, these are those compounds that can easily catch fire. So, they cause forest fire. Many species contain carbohydrates, which make them valuable source of food. For example, Cladonia species. These species are commonly known as reindeer moss, and they serve as a food for reindeers and other wild animals. Lichens are also used in various commercial products, for example, dyeing of silk and wool. And these are also used in making of litmus as acid or base indicator. They are also used in essential oils, soap, and perfumes. Lichens are also used in tanning of leather. They are used in fermentation industry for the formation of several kinds of beer. Many commercial compounds are found in the lichens thalli, which have medicinal value and are helpful in curing various diseases. For example, arsenic acid. It is produced by a number of lichen species, and this acid is used in preparation of antibacterial creams. Peltigera species is used to cure dog bites. Some lichens are used in preparation of anti-cancerous drugs. They are also used to cure tuberculosis and other pulmonary diseases. Certain lichens also contain substances that are toxic in nature. So this is all about the significance of the lichens. Thank you very much. For further reading, you may consult the book Introduction to Fungi by Webster and Weber. Thank you very much.